This is Whitley Strieber, and this is a Dreamland video presentation. You have reached the edge of the world. Today on Dreamland, we're going to be talking to Doug Kenyon about his book, Ghosts of Atlantis, How the Echoes of Lost Civilizations Influence Our Modern World. But before we go to Doug, I'd like to talk a little bit about the coming disclosure event, the effects of disclosure so far, and why it is that Dreamland is going to be exploring the lost past more completely over the next few months and years. The reason is really very simple. Now that the U.S. government has finally admitted that UFOs are of unknown origin, and that has been admitted, and the idea that they are something from China or Russia just doesn't hold water. Among other things, there's going to be released soon, apparently, information about underwater UFOs that have been tracked by the United States Navy that travel at hundreds of kilometers an hour. Now, if the Russians and the Chinese had something like that, we would have no Navy, but we do. Now, if you'll notice the way the media handles this, the general media has no past, for the most part. Some more searching journals, like the Wall Street Journal, the New York Times, perhaps the Guardian in England, do have a past. They do look more deeply. But for the most part, it doesn't. It has no past. And since the government has only released videos dating back as far as 2004, it's as if this all started in 2004, which is, of course, entirely false. It's not the case. In fact, it may be very much not the case, because it may not have started in 1947 with the Kenneth Arnold sighting and the Roswell incident. It might not have started in 1945 if the Trinity incident that Jacques Vallée and Pearl Harris are talking about really happened. It might have started very much longer before that. It may have started maybe before we started. Why do I say that? Well, there are traces all through the past, and that's what we're going to be examining more on Dreamland, because the whole archaeological community has got to circle back across the past and take a new look. And biology has to take a new look at our DNA and see if we can find traces of intervention. And they should be visible if they are there. Because look at us. Look at where we are. We are at the beginning development of the end of a real crisis. There is an extinction event going on here. Why is it happening? It's happening for only one reason. There are too many people on the planet. Now, why would that be? Why did we overpopulate the planet? We didn't do it on purpose. We didn't go out and run around thinking, oh, we have to have as many babies as possible, so we'll overpopulate the planet. We did it because of the way we are designed. Now, did somebody design us, or did nature do this? That's what we really need to find out. It's very important. Specifically, the design flaw works like this. We have big brains, wonderful minds, and tremendous imaginations, and marvelous memories. We are naked. We have large, prominent, forward-facing genitals, and we have no seasonality. That is a prescription for overpopulation, because we have a high capacity to survive because of our big brains. We have a great interest in sex because of our nakedness, our prominent genitals, and our mind, our imaginations and memories. And we have a very great tendency to have babies year around as a result of this. That's a design issue. And if somebody did design us, then they are responsible for what's happening now. Back in the 18th century, a scholar named Thomas Malthus figured all of this out, and he showed how the planet would inevitably become overpopulated by the exponential growth of the human population. Now, just at this moment, the population is beginning to decline slightly in parts of the world, not in all of it, but it's not increasing as fast as it was, say, 5 years ago, which is good. But we have outrun the planet's ability to support us. It's that simple. And there's going to be an extinction event, and it is not going to be our fault. There is fault, and the fault lies with people who are, I think, responding to an unconscious death wish, who are the climate change deniers and everyone who suggests policies that are going to lead to the collapse of the environment and a great dieback in the human species, if not complete extinction. Now, this is also part of nature. Species that overpopulate get this under their skin. I knew a man who studied overpopulation in rat mazes for years. It was, to me, a rather amazingly horrific profession, but he was fascinated with his work. He was a psychologist, and he said that as when the rats reach a certain point in terms of overpopulation, they begin to essentially go mad. They turn on each other, their social order collapses, and they become very violent, and they begin to wantonly murder each other. In other words, a death wish emerges in the rats because there are too many rats. The same thing, exact same thing, has been happening to us since the beginning of the 20th century. That's what World War I and World War II were really about, I think, at their core. They were extraordinary killing machines. Adolf Hitler, for example, was possessed by a phenomenal death wish. He wanted to kill not only the Jews and the Russians and everybody else around him, he wanted to kill the Germans. If he didn't want to kill the Germans, then why did he send the whole youth of that generation to their deaths on his mad fronts? Of course he did. He wouldn't have said that, but that was in him. It was a death wish, an instinctive death wish, and it's still out there, and it's very dangerous. Every time you hear someone denying climate change, they are responding to that instinct. They don't know it, but they are. Now, back to the issue of disclosure and what's about to happen. I think there is every reason to believe that these entities have been here for a long time. And I say entities, not aliens, because I'm not sure that's what they are. I have no reason to believe that. And I've been face to face with them a number of times in my life. And if they are from a parallel universe, I think that's quite possible. I think it might even be more possible than there being from somewhere else in this universe. The reason for this is that they get here at all. Right now, travel between planets is a it between stars, I should say, is something that we could not accomplish. And even if you could accomplish it, unless you have a way of moving outside of the rules of physics and faster than light and taking solid objects and like living beings along with you, it's going to take a long, long time to do that. You're going to have to travel faster than light to do that. Or you're going to have to go through a wormhole. Now, that said, there has recently been some paper, there have recently been some papers published about the possibility of human traversable wormholes. Well, if we are thinking about that now, someone who's 100 years, 1,000 years, or even 1,000,000 years in advance of us is going to be doing it from their hip pockets. I can imagine, if that's true, that not only is faster than light travel, but that some possible, but that someone could literally walk from their living room into yours across thousands of light years in just a second. I've seen the visitors appear and disappear before my eyes. And I thought, well, I think that's some kind of technology that's making them invisible. But what if they were walking in and out of the entire universe? It's certainly possible, I think, now. But nevertheless, wormholes between our universe and the parallel universe are going to require much less energy than wormholes between our universe and another, between our planet and another part of our universe. The reason is very simple. If you think of the universe as a kind of a curved form like this, and in order to make a wormhole, you have to very quickly bring the two parts of it together, and then they separate again. And while they're together, you jump across. But if you think of what it would be like to take a piece of steel and say a foot thick and bend it so that two edges of it are touching, two points on it are touching, you can imagine the amount of energy that it would take. Now, obviously, if you want to do that in this universe, it's going to take more energy than is in the universe to bend the universe. And that does not seem possible. But wormholes between this universe and a parallel universe are very possible. Having been in a parallel universe myself, I can assure you that they don't even require technology, or at least not technology I was aware of the existence of. And I have to tell you, that happened. It happened. It's described in detail in my book, A New World. And it was real. It was a real event over a 3-day period. And not only that, a few months later, I actually physically moved into the parallel universe twice, very briefly. So that happened too. It can happen. And if it can happen to me, perhaps due to technology that I was not aware of, or perhaps just naturally, it might explain an awful lot about our world. It might, for example, explain what in heaven's name is going on at the Skinwalker Ranch, because there's something going on there. There's little question about that. Now that we have an admission at the highest level that UFOs, or they call them UAPs now, are real. They call them UAPs, by the way, because it means unidentified aerial phenomenon. They don't know whether or not they are physical objects. Now, hopefully, among the things that will be released is material about some of the unusual metals that have been found. So they may actually know they are material objects. I've got some of that metal in this office, as I've said many times. And I will keep it until it can be studied in completely in the open world of science by credentialed scientists who are not there to lie about it and debunk it. I won't let that happen. I will keep it until the culture of science changes. And I think it's going to change very rapidly. I don't think there are a bunch of mean old fools who just are never aliens, no matter what. They can see and they can understand that this represents an extraordinary something, and there is the potential for an incredible advance of knowledge. And let me tell you this. The best minds, I don't think they live behind the secret barrier. I think they're out in the public. I don't think that there's ever been a Stephen Hawking or an Albert Einstein behind the wall of secrecy. The reason is very simple. You can have a big, important career and leave a mark on the world outside of the classified system. Inside it, all of your work remains hidden. And you never get to really advance in the outside world. I know scientists who've been threatened with having their work classified any number of times and are terrified of this happening and think of it as the ruin of their career and their lives. So the best minds haven't ever looked at the UFO situation. They haven't looked at the abductions. There are ways of looking, many ways of looking at both of them, if the will is there, the dedication is there, and the money is there. And I'm hoping that the emergence of this as a real mystery is going to loosen up a lot of high-level granting and proposals from highly trained and credentialed scientists in all kinds of different fields, not the least of which would be human biology, because we need to find out about our DNA in the context of the possibility that somebody may have altered it. Somebody may have done this to us. Why, if they did? Well, maybe they think they made a mistake, and maybe that's why they're here trying to correct it before it's too late, and their creation self-destructs because of the design flaw that they themselves put into it. Maybe they wanted us to self-destruct so the species would advance into some other level of consciousness. I don't know the answer to those questions, but I have my own ideas. I think, as I, you know, that who listen to the show, that the entities I call the visitors put on bodies the same way we put on diving. We put on scuba gear. I think they project themselves into the physical universe, essentially artificially. Could be wrong about that, but that's an idea I've had. In which case, they may not actually live in this reality at all, not in a parallel universe or anywhere, but in another level of reality. I think such levels exist. I wouldn't be wearing two rings if I wasn't still in contact with my wife, which I think I am. I'm almost certain I am. That's why she's always there when I do these shows, watching over us, because I believe that's exactly what's happening. Okay, I have talked enough, I think, and I'll be back talking some about developments, news-related developments, over the next few weeks before the shows start. And I will be talking at the end of some shows about the spiritual life for our subscribers who are mostly in on the website because they have had close encounters or are deeply curious about them. And that means that they have experienced some kind of an initiatory event, like what happened to me. What I mean by initiatory is something that overturns your entire worldview. Now, what happened to me on December the 26th, 1985, on that night, definitely overturned my worldview completely. Completely. And then I had to put myself back together again. Well, I'm put together. I'm very well put together at this point and functioning very smoothly with the presence, which is very much a part of my life. It is not dangerous to me at this time. And I'm doing reasonably well with it. The last three books I've written, Afterlife Revolution, written mostly with Anne, A New World, written mostly with the visitors, Jesus, A New Vision, written using the implant as a research tool and the wisdom of Anne helping in that, and probably others as well. And she's not alone in the world of the dead, I don't think. So, I've made use of my relationship with this presence, and I will continue to do so. Now, let's go on. Doug did not have a computer capable of doing video, so the interview with him is audio only, but it's a wonderful interview. Enjoy it anyway. Now, let's go to Doug Kenyon.
This is Whitley Strieber. Listen to me now from June of 2010 talking to Alan Lammers about an incredible thing that happened to him on the island of Sulawesi in Indonesia.
Here you are
in South Sulawesi in the little town in the district of Sandu Batu. You were, what happened? You were told something rather strange.
Well, we were told before we went, like my friends that I work with in, with the NGO, they told me that when you pack, because it kind of happened by accident, I went out to buy a raincoat. It rains quite a bit in this part of the world. And so I went out and I bought a yellow raincoat. And my friend said, I'm sorry, you can't take that to Walla Walla. And I said, well, why not? And he says, well, you can't wear that color. So anyways, excuse me. So I thought, okay, well, what colors can I wear? They said, well, you can only wear black or white. You cannot wear any bright colors, no bright green, especially no yellow. And, you know, that's all you should bring. And I said, well, what would happen? And they said, well, people disappear.
You will find the rest of that story, and it is brain-bending, in the June 5th edition of Dreamland, June 5, 2010 edition of Dreamland in the unknowncountry.com archive. This archive is one of the richest of its kind in the world, probably is the richest of its kind in the world, filled with extraordinary shows, of which this show is certainly one, this show with Alan Lammers. You will never have heard anything like it. It does what Dreamland is here to do. It opens your mind to the fact that we live inside a hidden reality that we prefer not to acknowledge, but not here. Here on unknowncountry.com, we do acknowledge it. We live in it and we love it. Subscribe today. You can't go wrong. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and get started. Well, I would like to now, after that preamble, introduce Doug Kenyon to the show. Doug will be with us on audio only. He is not got a setup that allows for the video system to work. But I'd like to tell you a little bit about what we're going to be doing. We're talking, as I said earlier, about ghosts of Atlantis, how the echoes of lost civilizations influence the modern world. And there are some beautiful statements. One of our absolute favorite Dreamland guests, Robert Schock, said of the book, a thought-provoking sampling of Atlantean themes and their ramifications. Now, Chris Dunn, another, we haven't had Chris on in too long, brilliantly elucidates how similar the fundamental ideological forces play out. Beautifully written. A magical mystery tour through many of the great puzzles and enigmas of our world. A deeply thought-provoking compendium. A tour de force that delivers a timely wake-up call from Scott Creighton. I mean, the book's the timely wake-up call, not the words from Scott Creighton, although he is quite a guy. All right, here we are. Welcome to Dreamland.
Well, thank you, Whitley. I'm happy to be here.
Yeah, we've had a bit of difficulty. I was supposed to talk to Scott earlier, and I had an auto disaster night before last. My brand new car, which I bought after 11 years of being pestered by my kids to buy a car with more safety features, proceeds to have a tire disintegrate on the highway, in a lonely highway in the middle of the night when I was driving back from a visit to some friends. All right. And so things have been a little bit discombobulated around here. Nobody's hurt, but there were Toyo tires on it, just for you to know, folks. I wouldn't trust a Toyo tire any further than I could throw it anymore. I got some Michelins. I'm getting put on to the car. The Atlantis of our dreams. One of the most interesting things about the book is its references to the unconscious aspect of this. Years ago, Barbara Hand Clow wrote a book called Catastrophobia, theorizing that we lived in a state of trauma, in effect, that the human species had PTSD in its DNA because of traumas that had struck us in the past. And I think that, let's talk to us, tell us a little bit about your vision of the way Atlantis lingers on in the mind, or behind the mind, I should say.
Well, I think, you know, certainly the idea of Atlantis is a familiar one. People have their own idea of what it's all about, and they will be inclined to, if they're not persuaded by the evidence, they'll be inclined to dismiss it. But I realize that whether they dismiss it or not, there's something there that is universal, and it's an archetype. It's an archetype it's of a deep sea diving explanation. You know, the idea that there's a ruin at the bottom, buried deep in our unconscious, where there are ghosts afoot. You know, where basically there are the haunted remnants of our own history that they continue to haunt us. And I think of, in Hamlet. Hamlet is haunted by the ghost of his father, who is basically crying out for justice. But, and whether or not you think of it in those terms or not, the idea is that there are components of ourselves that have been lost or buried, and that we really need to get back in touch with, because we're living in a world which is obviously very toxic, and there are elements that we need to look at. I'm not saying it's any fun. I'm not saying that this is going to be a pleasant undertaking. But I was trying to give people a way of thinking about it that goes a little bit deeper and a little bit further than the standard stereotype that that we run into.
But exactly, we need to go deeper, because the stereotypes that you mentioned in the book, Atlantis, the Lost Continent, and so forth, are all well and good. Let me ask you this. I have made an armchair study of quite a few ruins of the past. I have not traveled much, largely because of the expense of doing so. I can't afford it. But places like...
Welcome to the club.
Right. Places like Nan Madol or Sacsahuaman or, there's a long laundry list of these places where things exist that couldn't, in terms of the way we understand building techniques and the way we understand the movement of great weights. So was a technological civilization lost? It wasn't like this one, in the sense that you don't find the ruins of cell phones and computers anywhere. But something different was going on. Can you give us an idea of what you think it might have been?
Well, our good friend Colin Wilson, and also used to talk about what he thought, and we talk about this somewhat in the book. He thought the Neanderthals were really those who had this kind of soft technology, or this ability that gave them spiritual faculties that are now dormant, and they were able, therefore, they saw things holistically and so forth. It could be argued that it's the left side of the brain, you know, but I think it's not just a question. I don't think you look at it like it originates in the brain is going to help you very much, because I think the brain itself is just kind of a reducing valve that gives us a kind of limited access to a larger world that we don't ordinarily have access to. And so we're it's like looking through a keyhole and trying to see and understand the world beyond it. And of course it's very, very limited, but when you can get through the keyhole and actually see what's there, and that's one of the reasons why we took the approach in the book of just trying to cover as many subjects as we could that were relevant to the subject to basically make people aware that this is a bigger thing than they have perhaps considered, that there's more to it. It has broader ramifications.
In the book, in The Ghosts of Atlantis, there's a very interesting paragraph or two that relates directly to what you just said. For many esoteric traditions, a key to understanding the ancient warfare of good and evil on both the planetary and personal level is a mysterious phantom called the Dweller or the Guardian on the Threshold. And then you go on to quote the great Manly P. Hall, "The first great step in the initiations of the ancients was the passing of the strange monster that dwelt on the line between the physical and spiritual worlds." Well, isn't that sort of what's happening now on a massive scale? I mean,
That's part of our point. That's part of our point.
Could you expand on that?
Well, Manly Hall suggested, even in this, we quoted him from remarks he made in like the 1920s, but he said he was trying to say that the accumulation of all the bad stuff you've ever done, all and so forth, is something that you ultimately have to confront, and that if you don't do it, then that's why you keep re-embodying. And I mean, this is the idea in reincarnation. We talk about that, and that, of course, is what we're talking. We're talking about a process by which we grow, and the way we learn, and the way we and if we respond with virtue to the challenges which come to us, then we basically we do okay when we're facing the final challenge. But when we accumulate, selfish activity and so forth, and it basically becomes a burden that weighs us down, and it can be understood. And we talk about various there in romantic literature. This idea comes up a lot. I'm thinking about things like Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, and other stories which basically talk about the trouble we get into if we don't address, if we don't behave properly, to put it simply.
And when you say don't behave properly, I have to ask you what you mean, because all of us listening to you are thinking the same thing. What about me?
Yeah, I think that the kind of behavior we have to watch about is watch out for is essentially destructive behavior, or so forth, where someone puts their own limited values ahead of the greater good, and therefore runs up. You can think of it like money, karma is like money, or like in the sense that you create debts that you ultimately you have to pay off. And this is the basic idea of karma, that you're responsible for your action, and cause has an effect. Those who live by the sword die by the sword. You understand perfectly, I'm sure, what I'm talking about.
I understand it, but I think you might have some really interesting wisdom to add, valuable.
wisdom. And let me personalize this a little bit, because oddly enough, this is turns out in this moment, this is a very personal thing, because this is kind of where I am right now. I had the communion experience, which Jeff Kripal explained to me was initiatory, which I had understood pretty much. But Manly Hall goes on to say, the children of light were told that they could never go forth into distant lands or earn the wages of master builders until they faced with courage and resolve the demon that dwelt ever within them but was invisible, until they sought to awaken within themselves the subtle forces of which he was composed. This fearful specter was the sum total of all the sins of each individual, which must be confronted before one can be free of the limitations of mortality. This is the life I am leading, and a lot of people now are leading. My book, Jesus, A New Vision, is a tool to enable people who have no access to the deeply good teachings in the world to reaccess them through the Jesus material. It's primarily a book for Westerners who have no longer buy into religious doctrine and don't have any real place to go. And it strips away the religious doctrine and takes you back to the basic ideas that are there, that are in all religions. But it does it from a Western viewpoint. Now, this is something we are needing to do now, because we've got to, isn't this a do or die situation, Douglas?
Well, I think you're right. I mean, and the, you know, the problem is that what we're talking about is the realization that there are other dimensions to the human experience than simply the material things that most people focus on, that their attention is completely absorbed in. And we make the point in the book, in fact, that there in that chapter you're looking at, is that we're talking about addiction, and we're talking about the attachment that people have to things that are worthless. And this is something that is right now, there's everybody's dancing to the dance, you know, so to speak, and it has its overwhelming frenzied quality, which is constantly drawing people deeper and deeper into this deception that they're facing, and further from from seeing the you know, the clear light that enables them to actually recognize what they're going through. And of course, that's something that the culture basically is encouraging in us to pursue that meaningless path. And so the awakening of the dormant, or the ancient awareness, or the ancient knowledge is basically being driven underground. It's being driven deeper and deeper. It's not going away, but it's ceasing to be in the public marketplace where it
right.
should be. And therefore, we're basically being tempted to I hate to use religious terms. To me, this is beyond religion. This is strictly...
Exactly.
This is cause and effect. It's basically natural law at work. This is the way things are. All religions do is they attempt in their own way to somehow or other to interpret natural law, and they try to treat it in a coherent way. And of course, you know, they make a lot of mistakes and so forth, and we all know that that there's fanaticism and dogmatism and a lot of misuses of the process. But the thing is that the fundamental underlying reality is what we need to get in touch with, and that's largely what the book was attempting to do. I mean, we covered a whole bunch of subjects, as you know, and we basically tried to provide a lot of scientific evidence supporting the truth of what we were trying to say. We're not trying to say you should pay attention to what we're saying simply because it sounds good or it's our opinion. We produced a lot of evidence that made people, that I hope will make people think about things they haven't thought about. And it's pretty, it actually cumulative, I think, is pretty powerful.
Well, it comes also at a time when we're going to have to understand what's happening to us in a new way. People are beginning to realize that there's something going on here that we don't understand. I mean, we are talking, the Department of Defense's Inspector General is querying all of the intelligence agencies, including the military ones, as to why they have been ridiculing the UFO phenomenon while privately being very concerned about it, something Admiral Roscoe Hillencoder, the first director of the CIA, said 60 years ago was happening, and it is. So we have to understand this on a higher level. This is a human initiatory moment, part of the process of waking up. And that's why I want to go all the way back to the distant past, folks. Linda Moulton Howe and I, who talk on the phone a lot, we just converse about everything and nothing, and mostly everything. There's an extraordinary chapter in here called The Nukes of Mars. Is there an ancient connection with the Earth? And could you tell us a little bit about why you would even have a chapter like that? What nukes of Mars? Oh, pardon me, free dreamlanders. I've got some good news or some bad news, depending on whether or not you want to listen to these commercials. We'll be right back.
They are found deep in a dying jungle, 6 infants. They aren't apes. They aren't human either, not quite. So what are they? When they are spirited off to the United States, an incredible discovery is made. They are as smart as us, but not us, not human. The company that found them wants to buy and sell them as the most valuable animals on Earth, brilliant workers who need not be paid. Somebody has to stop this travesty, and that's where primatologist Beth Cook comes in. But can she stand up to the power and wealth that seeks to exploit them? Find out in Whitley Strieber's first standalone science fiction novel in 7 years. New. Get it on Amazon as an ebook or paperback.
As a subscriber of Dreamland for many years, it's been an incredible adventure and truly a Rosetta Stone for so many of the experiences that all of your listeners have had. Please join us. It's a fantastic ride. But I will say that certainly Dreamland does reflect something that I've always known, that man's mind mirrors a universe that mirrors man's mind. And no other place will you get this truth than on Dreamland. Come join us.
Some of the most thrilling, mind-opening interviews ever recorded are in the Dreamland Archive. Open your mind to Sir Lawrence Gardner's brilliant vision of the past. Listen to Russell Targ's phenomenal insights about ESP. Be inspired by Dr. Eben Alexander's stunning near-death experience. Listen to an actual recording from a plane as it was attacked by a gigantic flying disc. Be transported to a new level of inner grace with Whitley Strieber's meditations. Enjoy The Communion, Transformation, Majestic, Secret School, and Superstorm audiobooks, and so much more. The UnknownCountry.com subscriber section. As little as 10 cents a day. Priceless.
We're talking to Doug Kenyon. His new book, Ghosts of Atlantis, How the Echoes of Lost Civilizations Influence Our Modern World. Enormously important right now, because it is actually happening. People think of the UFO phenomenon, the UAP phenomenon, as something new, and that's how it's going to be portrayed in the media. It is not. It is something that is part of us and part of the world around us. It is deeply initiatory and very different from what they say. Doug's website is AtlantisRising.com, the marvelous magazine, Atlantis Rising. I remember so fondly the glory days when I would open the mailbox, when we opened our mailboxes for things other than a local rag newsletters or whatever, and got something. And there would be Atlantis Rising, and Ann and I would know that we had a few days of really interesting discussion ahead. You can get so much of that immense wealth of material from the magazine on AtlantisRising.com, as well as keep up with Doug and his current work. Okay, the nukes of Mars. And I say this, it's so strange. Linda and I were talking about John Brandenburg and the nukes of Mars yesterday evening, which to me strengthens the importance of talking about it now, because you deal with it in such a fascinating way in this book. Can you first, and for subscribers, there's a wonderful interview with John Brandenburg on unknowncountry.com. Just search Brandenburg, and there may be two of them actually, and we'll have to have him on again. He's a brilliant and extraordinary man. Can you tell us a little bit about this?
Well, I just wanted to say that John Brandenburg participated in a conference that we had in 99, and we have quite a bit of streaming content from that with him that we are offering. I don't know if we've edited that particular one fully yet. I know it's going to be going up soon. It is available as for streaming download on our website.
Well, wonderful, because it's well worth this. His work is one of the most interesting things. Can you tell us a little bit about him?
Well, he's a nuclear physicist, and basically he has pursued the evidence of what is going on Mars to a degree that he is willing to say that there is evidence of past life and past civilization on Mars, which was basically destroyed in some kind of cataclysm, some kind of nuclear catastrophe. He thinks, as I recall, he thinks there's evidence of maybe two nuclear blasts on Mars, and he thinks this accounts for a lot of what we observe on Mars. He's not trying to say that it's all the result of nuclear activity. However, all of this does fit nicely into some theories that were basically kind of obscure and not widely known that have been around for a while. One is called the Phaeton theory, and so forth, where you're talking about a collision between planets and the evidence for that, and of course he would see the nuclear holocaust, of some kind on Mars. And I mean, he's got very very reliable. I mean, he's talking about actual numbers of certain elements that are presently found on Mars, and this is documentable. And his work has been noticed by the mainstream news to some extent.
But also, you know, we have stories of ancient wars in the sky here on Earth, and there are areas of the Middle East that have trinitite in them. And trinitite, as folks, is only created by nuclear explosions.
Yeah, yeah. And we talk about that a little bit in the book. I think there's a lot of interest right now in ancient Vedic civilization, because, and by that I mean in India, and particularly the Harappan part of the Harappan origin of Bedi culture in India. Harappa, of course, is one of the sites where they do believe, as people say, that there's evidence of a Mohenjo-Daro. They see evidence, they think, of a possible nuclear cataclysm. It's controversial, but the thing is, we're talking about a civilization there that is far more ancient than is generally understood or believed. And certainly within the Vedic scriptures, and I'm talking about the Mahabharata and the Bhagavad Gita and so forth, there are many descriptions that sound like they are describing a nuclear holocaust of some kind. And you put all that together, you know, and then you start to see that there is a missing element in our past that we have completely lost touch with. And I mean, I think there have been many forms of catastrophe throughout our long history, and many of them have just totally wiped us out, left us basically to start over again. And the result, of course, is that we find ourselves with amnesia. And that's part of the point that we're trying to make.
Which gets back to Barbara Hand-Clow's theory.
Yeah.
That we are in a state of amnesia.
It's funny. I did talk to her quite a bit about these very things in the early days of the magazine. And we were on the same page on that one, that's for sure.
Exactly. And yeah, there's a wonderful interview with her on my website. God, it has become such a treasure trove of stuff. So folks, if you're a subscriber, you can listen to the Barbara Hand-Clow 2 interviews on this whole idea of us being in a state of catastrophobia, as she calls it.
Yeah,
but I think that what's happening now, Douglas, in my sense of it, is that as our planet becomes unable to sustain us, we are waking up both to its danger and our danger, and necessarily also to who we really are and where we came from. You know, years ago, I got a letter from a lady, and my listeners have heard me tell this story before, from Tennessee, who was walking in the woods with her little boy, and a man in a dark blue uniform, a short man, like what I call a kobold, I would guess, came out of a cave and said that he was a rebel and he had a message for us. The message was that there had been a long ago war between Earth and Mars, and we had destroyed the surface of their planet and completely stripped it of all life. But they had captured our souls and condemned us to recirculate forever and ever and ever on Earth, and that their name for Earth was Dead Forever. Now, I wonder about things like that because I see a way out. And my life, in a sense, is about a way out, even if that's not an accurate description of what happened. This circular existence is real. Can you tell us, give us a little bit about your understanding of rebirth and recurrence and getting off the wheel of recurrence?
Well, I think you're right on as far as the origin of this, and that there is, I mean, I really go along with the ancient Hindu notion that we're, except I don't believe that it's that we're bound forever. I think there is an opportunity to graduate from this process, but I do believe that we touched on it earlier, but when you're, that if you want to understand life, you have to look at it in a larger perspective. And you can't see the current life as being adequate, not being adequate to address all the issues that we have to address. And you realize that the design of things meant that we had to have a much larger canvas to paint on, and that we're talking in time and spread over time. You know, ultimately you have the wheels go round and round, and you ultimately find yourself coming back to the origin of things, of causes that you set in motion. And when you come to that, then basically you have to you either add to the score and improve your position, or you exacerbate it, and you end up having to go back to and repeat, and you go deeper into the difficulty. But everything is very intelligent. You know, everything is, this is not random. This is, everything is occurring in a very orderly process, not disorderly. And of course, as to the extent that we violate the laws involved, we create on our own all the chaos in which we find ourselves.
And exactly, we feel like we've created the situation we are in, which is one of the sources of catastrophobia. We blame ourselves. And I'm always unsure of that. In my book, A New World, it became obvious to me that the real blame for our pickle we're in is population growth. And we're not responsible for that, actually. If we're a designed species, somebody else designed us this way, with no seasonality, prominent genitals, big brains, and no fur. This adds up to someone who's going to be real interested in sex. And what about that? Could we be a designer species?
Well, that's a tricky question. I won't attempt to. I'll just say that along those lines, Elon Musk was making some very interesting statements the other day that impressed me, which was, he was saying that the real problem we're going to have going forward is the collapse of our population. That is because of and you can already see it in the sense of those who are the disparity between those who are very old and very young in terms of their numbers has basically the old, and I speak as one of those myself, who is basically dependent upon the labor and the efforts of those who are much younger. And as that trend continues, clearly it's going to be on a demographic level alone, it's going to be a problem. But I think that the intention of the design of the human race was to be fruitful and multiply. And that is basically what we don't have to fear that process. We have to fear there was a time of 30 years ago when it looked, I mean, to listen to some tell it, it was the principal threat facing the planet. But that's totally changed in recent years, because I mean, the destructive forces that are about we have to be able to deal with that. And I'm sorry for branching off into a different area there.
No, it's not a different area. This is about the possibility that we may be in a situation where we're not going to advance, but that we're going to fall back into a very dark place, because
That's a real possibility.
A real possibility, because we're sitting in the middle of an rapidly advancing extinction event. I mean, I remember when there was consternation because a single type of amphibian, of little frog,
was going extinct. Or I remember the snail darter episode where people were angry because the government was trying to prevent this little type of fish called a snail darter from going extinct. Now there are so many species going extinct, we can't even count them. We think 52,000 different animal species. The insects are literally disappearing before our eyes. We're in an extinction event. And it's like we are on a trajectory that passes very close to the sun. And are we going to burn up or be projected out by the gravitational force of the sun as we loop around it into a new life?
All of this is why we need to recover lost knowledge of prior visits to this particular point of the wheel. We have to go back and recover somehow or other the knowledge that we've lost, and we have to figure out, you know, where we went wrong, and we have to basically address the issues that are involved in that. And now is the time when we're being compelled by the very circumstances you allude to do this.
Well, you know, a few weeks ago on Dreamland, we had Robert Schock on for one of his many visits, and he described to us vividly what happened in this planet 12,000 years ago. And that's about halfway around the precession of the equinox. And what it was like to live through it. I guess I'm kind of wandering a bit with my question, because I'm not sure whether I want to ask you what they lost or what we need to find. And maybe the question is the same question. Something was lost. We can't build the platform at Baalbek anymore. We can't build those other places I talked about earlier anymore either. What was the basic thing you think might have been lost?
Well, I suspect that what we really need to do, which all of the specific knowledge, you might say, technical knowledge, et cetera, might flow from, is we needed to graduate to a greater understanding of our own personal selves, who we are, why we're here, what we're doing, and I think that I suspect that in the past, there may have been some who had that, who achieved that kind of knowledge or kind of awakening conscious state that we're talking about. But they were at the mercy of those who had not achieved it. I mean, and therefore, they ended up losing out. I mean, losing out as far as the external events were concerned. Part of the thing is that we need to become the inner reality has got to become our dominant reality, instead of being something that of which we're barely conscious and we're barely aware of. It needs to get our full attention, and we need to be able to look deeply at cause and effect, and seeing how we got into this state, and therefore to be, you know, so we can somehow or other work a way out of it.
You know, I think that it's not so much lost technology as lost self-knowledge. And
exactly,
Free Dreamlanders, we have to take a break now and use this to increase your self-knowledge. We'll be right back.
Contact in the Desert 2021. The journey continues.
When you start to ask the question, it unfolds the fabric of space itself, how it's made. What is it made of?
We're We're not alone in this universe. We never have been.
Alien intelligences have cohabited with us on this planet for millions of years.
We inherited the obsession from the Anunnaki.
Anyone that still thinks that we're the ones that are obsessed with gold does not know enough about the true history of our species, how we came to be here,
and the conditions that brought us here.
We are not unique in this universe. Extraterrestrials do exist. We are, so to say, the copies of them.
Contact in the Desert 2021 goes virtual. Go to contactinthedesert.com to find out more.
My most recent three books, Afterlife Revolution, A New World, and Jesus, A New Vision, are a series designed to lead to a rich and useful experience of contact for us. Afterlife Revolution starts the series by showing that what we call the dead still exist and can and will become part of our lives as companions and teachers of a whole new kind. A New World central theme is about the relationship between us and the presence, which includes our visitors, our dead, and other aspects of consciousness that we perhaps cannot describe in words. It discusses the deepest meaning of communion between us and them. It is frank about the dangers and plain-spoken about the methods. The third book, Jesus, A New Vision, is there for people who are not involved with religion, and for those who are, too, of course, so that they can gain access to the teaching of Jesus about how to live with and for the good. For it is living in this way, as an ally of the good, that we can form our relationship with our visitors into something valuable to us. If you have not read all three books, I urge you now to get the ones you haven't read, listen to them on audio, read them on Kindle or in paper form, however you prefer. They are part of our way forward, each of them in its own way. We're talking to Doug Kenyon, his new book, Ghosts of Atlantis. He's the original publisher of Atlantis Rising magazine. And this magnificent output is largely available now on AtlantisRising.com. Go and search and journey through that garden of wonder. The new book is How the Echoes of Lost Civilizations Influence Our Modern World. Now, let's talk about human powers. I think that it wasn't technology that did those remarkable things. I think it was us. And the reason I think that is, well, a perfect example is in Jesus, A New Vision, and in the story of the Shroud of Turin, which is supposedly dismissed as a fake, and it's not a fake. A man turned into basically a being of light in that tomb. Yep. Now, he was not, maybe he was just a human being. And maybe that is a lost human power, and maybe we have a lot of them. So could you talk about, give us your impressions of lost human powers?
You know, I agree. In fact, one of our books, which is a kind of an anthology from some of our articles, is Lost Powers. But I'm basically, I agree that a lot of what we attribute to technology in the ancient and forgotten past may have very well been the use of what John Anthony West used to call soft power, or people like Stan Gooch and so forth have written about as the perhaps this is something that the Neanderthals had at their disposal that we don't have, but it's the development of the intuitive side, the development of the inner vision and inner sight that gave them a mastery over external physical things that that is alien to us today. We don't understand it, certainly in the materialistic objective world in which we live. these things are dismissed as nothing but superstition, but they are in fact real. And there is evidence that the ancients had ways of doing these things. I mean, you talk about lifting large objects. I think that possibly they had an ability to levitate, and they could do so. John Michel used to talk about how people would collectively, groups of people would chant or engage in the use of particular sounds and so forth, and led by advanced priests. Perhaps even the Druids were doing some of this, and maybe that's how Stonehenge was created. But these are the things that were developed to the level of science and to the level and to a level of mastery, which is now just dismissed as being a total fairy tale. But I think that there's evidence. I mean, how else are you going to explain some of these anomalous structures when they didn't obviously have the machine tools that we have today?
Well, we still don't have the machine tools to do some of them.
I know.
We can't build Baalbek.
No. And even smaller things like those diorite vases in the Cairo Museum,
right, which
where it has extremely hard but extremely precisely designed artifacts that were basically created on some kind of a lathe or seemingly on a lathe, but you couldn't do it on a lathe.
Well, exactly. And yeah, Graham Hancock talks about those extensively in Fingerprints of the Gods. Let's go to another place on Earth to explore this in a slightly different way. I want to go to Tara in Ireland, to the Stone of Destiny, and because it may be in some way, the lore of this may be connected with our missing history in some surprising ways, I think. Can you discuss, you have a very interesting discussion of Bronze Age DNA and so forth. Can you kind of pick it up from there and tell us what you think might have been going on to make this this stone a significant reminder?
Well, there's evidence, you know, that there may have been in DNA that they find in places in certain parts of Ireland and Scotland that indicate that perhaps there is a connection there with ancient Egypt. And actually, it ties into legends that that there was a princess, Skoda, is her name, who perhaps was a refugee from exile of the Israelites from Egypt, and that perhaps that she and her family returned to Ireland and were basically where they were participants in some of the wars of the time, and they ended up establishing their own lineage as being a royal lineage in Scotland. I think this goes along with the notion that there is the biblical Hebrews or so forth were dispersed throughout the world and may very well have been lost tribes that are now lost to history and were scattered abroad. And that this accounts for some of the developments of history, perhaps even the royal lines of Europe, and perhaps even I mean, this is a very controversial area. I'm not saying that I agree with it or not. I'm just saying that there's very interesting evidence for some of it.
There is in Atlantis Rising, number 116, an article called Junk DNA or Not. When I was going through your book, I was amazed to see this mentioned specifically, because I thought when I read the article originally, it was terribly important. And it in the book, you lead from there into Michael Drosnin's very unfortunately rejected book, The Bible Code and Healing Codes for the Biological Apocalypse. Can you tell us about these lost codes and where they are and what they may mean?
Well, if I knew all of that, I wouldn't be, I would probably, you'd probably have to kill me.
I'm looking for speculation here. We're very innocent here. No intelligence operatives need to apply.
Well, I understand. We did have a chapter talking about codes and in the book, and there's certainly a lot of evidence that codes have played a very important part in history. And certainly, I think that that's you get into the notion that Francis Bacon, for one, probably used a lot of these himself, and he was considered to be the creator of a lot of these coding methods that were. And this kind of counts the whole idea of what's esoteric versus what's exoteric. And I just mean that the idea is that secret societies have a teaching that is intended for the initiated, and they are, and it's more refined and more developed. And then those who are not initiated are in like the to use the biblical idea, they're in the outer court, and they're not getting the full story. And I think that there's a lot. You have to be aware of this, and you can see it in various codes and ciphers and so forth to really kind of understand some of the tangles of history. And we talk about that quite a bit in the book. There's a good chapter on that.
Yes, there is. I would like to read briefly from the book, because I think what I'm going to read is a really important key to what has been lost. In 1999, two American doctors published Healing Codes for the Biological Apocalypse, in which they claimed to have found codes in the Book of Numbers that could be used to repair damaged DNA. Dr. Joseph Puleo and Dr. Leonard Horowitz say they have found nothing less than an electromagnetic frequency code for miracles. Using the ancient Pythagorean method to reduce the verse numbers of a particular segment of the Book of Numbers to single-digit integers, Puleo discovered a series of electromagnetic sound frequencies. These, he says, though once known and understood by the church to have healing properties and used in Gregorian chant, have been lost. Now, let's go back to the engineering of the past that we no longer understand. And I put it to you, could sound be the technology that we have lost? Sound of a kind that we have forgotten even exists?
I think so. As a matter of fact, you know, I think this is really clear if you look at in the Mediterranean. I'm not thinking about Cyprus. I'm thinking about here I'm having a senior moment, but at any rate, where the temples are curved, the walls are curved in a way that matches where the sound was being echoing back through that.
Right. Somebody knew something about sound in the past that we have lost.
That
is absolutely crystal clear. Well, Doug, I know you've got miles to go before you sleep today, and I would like to thank you for spending time with us on Dreamland. The book is Ghosts of Atlantis, How the Echoes of Lost Civilizations Influence Our Modern World. And folks, as I said in the first half hour of the show, I'm going to repeat it now. We can't understand what's happening now in the context of a recent appearance of aliens from another planet. That's not it. There's more here. And to look into the distant past, to pick up the clues that we need to pick up, this is what is so essential. And books of like Ghosts of Atlantis pull together all kinds of thread ends and knot some of them together and leave others open. But it's a rich treasure house. Doesn't tell you where to exactly what's in the treasure house of the past, but it gives you some good ideas about where to go. Doug Kenyon, thank you so much for being with us on Dreamland. And folks, do not fail to explore AtlantisRising.com. It's glorious.
Thank you so much, Whitley, for the invitation and the really terrific conversation there.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.